Hi, this is Tim and Joel. Welcome to Midwest Hunting and Outdoors by Two Dumbasses,
a podcast about the outdoors, hunting,
and being a steward of the land.
Hi, welcome to Midwest Hunting and Outdoors. We are privileged today to have a special guest with us, Rachel Rudin from the Iowa DNR, and she is the state's veterinarian for management diseases. Did I say that right?
Yeah, state wildlife veterinarian. Yep. Yeah,
okay. So one of the things we do every week, Rachel, is we kind of banter back and forth before we start, and we kind of talk about, hey, what'd you do this week? And we're going to kind of skip you, but we're going to come back to you. So just FYI. So JJ, what'd you do this week?
I bought a new Radix elevated hunting hunting tower. And for folks that don't know, those things are fantastic. I'd highly encourage them. I'm a big fan. And however, they come in three boxes. And it's like Legos putting them together, and it can be a task. So I called my brother up and bribed him to come down fishing with me. But first, you got to help me put together this hunting tower, right? So 6 hours later, we have the hunting tower put together and in location, and secured and safe. So I'm super, super excited about having that. It's in a new location from a hunting standpoint, and over a food plot down below by the creek, and super excited about hunting out of that this year.
Nice. Those Radix blinds are super nice. I know their capacity is 800 pounds, so it holds easily three people, very spacious. Did you happen to get anything else with those blinds? They have some really nice chairs.
I purchased two chairs to go with it. I had an existing hunting hut that I made myself, but was always shuffling chairs around from hunting location to location. So I bought two chairs, one chair for this hunting hut, one chair is for my existing hunting hut, and now I don't have to move things around, and I'm excited about it.
Nice.
Yeah.
Nice. Anything else?
No, I'm good. I mean, that was a big success for me.
So this week, we went down to our seed supplier down in Keosauqua, Iowa. We're going to have a discussion with that gentleman here in the future about food plots. So we picked up seed not only for us, but also for a plethora of other people. So like last year, we bought like 5 acres worth of seed from this guy. And this year, we're up to 15 acres of seed. So it's a proven seed supplier. We'll just leave it at that at this juncture. Also, what happened is there was a deer echo that went across the state of Iowa. I don't know if people or listeners had ever heard of that. I know I hadn't. But how it's been described to me is like an inland hurricane without the eye. And it's probably one of the worst things I've seen. I have a lot of family and relatives up in Cedar Rapids, Marion. I think if it was the eye of the storm, if from a hit perspective. So I went up and helped them on Tuesday, ran a chainsaw for 12 hours trying to help people. And went up again on Sunday. So that's pretty much what I did. That brings us to our special guest, Rachel Rudin. And am I saying that right?
Yeah.
Okay. So, Rachel, what did you do this past week?
Well, I was recovering from the derecho. That's how I heard the pronunciation.
Derecho.
Yeah, but it kind of sounds like my name. So
okay.
Maybe I'm preferential. but, yeah, Ames got completely knocked out off the power grid. So I was out without power for about 4 days. And then before I ever got power back, I had to jump down to Miami for the birth of my first niece. So,
oh, hey, congratulations.
Yeah, that's awesome. So it was a busy, bizarre week, but happy I'm on the other side.
That's right. So with that, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself, your position, your interests, you know, that sort of stuff.
Sure. So so I am Iowa's first state wildlife veterinarian. This is a position that was created right about the beginning of 2019. I assumed the role in July, so I just closed out 1 year in the job. So through that, I basically consult on all kinds of wildlife health morbidity, so meaning like disease, kind of ill or sick looking animals, and then mortality events, meaning, you know, just dead animals that are found by landowners or, you know, concerned citizens, that kind of thing. Through my role, I also have a 20% time commitment with the Iowa State, both the vet diagnostic lab and then also the vet school. So it's proving to be a really great partnership because we have access to all those resources, and then, you know, I can provide consultations on.
What a great way to learn too, right? I mean, geez, what a better, oh my gosh.
With COVID, it's a little challenging trying to get kind of students involved with me yet, but that's kind of where the role will grow into, is taking students out, having them see if there's an event, you know, how to, what kind of samples to pull or what kind of questions to ask, that kind of thing.
So, yeah, it makes total sense.
Yeah, so it's a really cool, it's my dream job. So it was very nice to find right when I was at the point of looking for a job. I came out here in 2016 to Ames for a PhD in wildlife disease ecology. So very much within the purview of my current role, you know, but there was kind of a long academic lead up to that. Went to college at Cornell University in New York, then vet school in Philly, and then another graduate degree at Iowa State. So
well, you're covering the whole spectrum. I mean, Cornell, Philly, and Ames.
Yep. Yep.
Well, congratulations. You've already got the Iowa accent down pretty well. So, yeah, working on it.
Yeah, for sure.
So from an interests and hobbies perspective, why don't you tell them what do you like to do?
Yeah, so, well, I tried to go full-fledged assimilation when I came out here. So I started cycling a lot, did my first RAGBRAI in 2017, was hoping to do another RAGBRAI this year, which got upended by the pandemic, but next year, eyes on 2021.
Yep.
And basically just anything wildlife related. I kind of say that I'm one-dimensional, but in a multifaceted kind of way. So, you know, wildlife photography, hiking, that's really what got me into biking, was looking for things like snakes and birds, you know, along the trail. So it's kind of a multi-purpose tool.
Yeah. So are you a hunter?
I am not. My family, that's just not kind of the culture that I grew up in, but I really appreciate that kind of family aspect and friendship out here.
Mm-hmm. So you're from where? New Jersey?
So
right?
I'm from, New Jersey, central New Jersey.
So, I mean, I'm not from New Jersey. I've got relatives out there, but it's not a big hunting state anyway, is it? I mean, or is it?
I'm sure that there's populations. I just never personally interacted with them. You know, upstate New York has a lot of hunting. Sure. Pennsylvania. I spent some time out in Alaska, so subsistence hunting is, you know, just to survive out there.
Yeah.
So I have a deep appreciation for hunting, and more so now as a disease management tool, which is what I kind of work with on a day-to-day basis.
Okay. Excellent. So, I know you came here from New Jersey, but why Iowa? How'd you pick Iowa? Or Iowa State for that matter?
Yeah. So, you know, in vet school, we had a couple of options, you know, it was small animal, mixed, large animal. So that's all domestic species. There wasn't really a wildlife option or a kind of a public health option. So I really felt like I wanted additional training on the wildlife side, since that's where my, you know, passions really laid. So I saw a posting by who eventually became my PI, Jim Adelman, At Iowa State, so in the Department of Natural Resource Ecology and Management, and the actual degree was wildlife ecology. My focus was disease ecology, so the movement of diseases basically through populations and across landscapes. So very relevant, as it turns out right now, during a pandemic, very relevant for a number of wildlife disease issues we have in the state. So it ended up like as if I had designed this, with some sort of foresight, but it just kind of really worked out for me.
That's great timing.
Well, the old saying, it's better to be lucky than good, right?
Exactly.
So yeah, can always get good.
Yeah.
I don't know how to get lucky.
Yep, exactly.
Yeah, so very good. So, what have you always wanted to be a veterinarian or?
Yeah, so, I always wanted to be a vet for a really long time. I grew up riding horses and things like that. So I wanted to be an equine surgeon because I thought that was the most prestigious, hardest, challenging career. As it turns out, it's also just, it's stressful, but in a very particular way, a certain clientele, and I just ended up kind of moving away from that and kind of fell in love with, wildlife was always there, but I didn't think it was practical. But with more training, you get more. With every round of academic training, you get more niche focused, which also weeds out a lot of other people. So at the end of the day, there's only so many people that are really equipped to do kind of what you do.
Good
so
job,
it
security.
It worked out for me.
Nice. Good job, security, Rachel. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And diseases aren't going away. So definitely have a job for the future, career in the future.
Exactly.
So you mentioned earlier about you work with landowners and where they have dead wildlife. I'd like to explore it. I didn't even really know that even existed. So tell me how that works.
Yeah. So occasionally I'll just get a cold call from a landowner who, through our kind of like help line, they get directed to me. More often I get, I'll kind of consult on observations that field staff have received. So, a unit that hears about some dead squirrels. Previous to my position, they'd have to kind of triage that situation, figure out if it's worth further, investigation and follow up. And there wasn't necessarily the training to really guide those decisions.
Sure.
They're tasked with managing habitat and all kinds of other things. So having a wildlife health person that's dedicated to wildlife health is, I think, really important. And they definitely, the DNR, felt that there was that need that that they could really use a position to meet that need. So that's kind of the origin of my position, was that it wasn't, related specifically to any one disease. It was just kind of anything could be on the horizon, and having someone who can kind of manage and coordinate a response is a great tool to have.
Okay, so was there a dead squirrel?
There have been some dead squirrels.
Yeah.
Yeah. I get a lot. I'll get a lot of game species calls because people are out there,
sure,
observing things like turkey and deer. So, and they're a little bit, larger, more prominent on the landscape. So I will get a fair number of calls about that. But also, in more urban settings like raccoons, canine distemper virus circulates kind of in these small pockets in raccoons in different urban centers or small cities. So every now and again, I'll consult on something like that. And it's nice to have that kind of overview of what's happening across the state, not in like the microcosm of one unit or one city. That's kind of what role I fill.
We could use a little distemper in Southern Iowa.
Well, you haven't been listening to a lot of our podcasts, but I'm not a fan of the raccoons.
Yeah.
So
there's a plethora of them.
We have a lot of raccoons.
Yeah.
Yeah, they're a problem. Yeah.
I think on this one hillside, I'm not exaggerating, I think there's at least 100.
Yeah.
100 raccoons. Maybe 150.
Well, sounds like the habitat can sustain them. So.
Well, not so much.
That sounds like a
good
an answer.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Good DNR answer. Yeah, yeah,
yeah. So moving.
Hey, can I interrupt there on that topic before we move on? So, first of all, congratulations on making it that first year. I'm sure that's the toughest one, I'm hoping. But What's your most memorable cold call that you got having to deal with, you know, hey, I've got this fill in the blank and here's what I'm seeing and what do you think kind of thing? Anything sure. that comes to head?
It's so varied. There's just so many like peculiarities and trying to think. I mean, I think the most rewarding is when it's like a person who has been, you know, has been trying to create a habitat for their wildlife. It might just be their backyard. It might be on acreage. And, you know, so they know the habits of their animals, you know, their the collective animals. And when they are concerned, you know, they want to have an outlet to express that in case it is actually a real, you know, an issue that needs additional attention. Yeah. So I think, I don't know if I could say like the weirdest or most memorable, but I think the most rewarding is just getting kind of that personal interaction and kind of seeing, you know, I think when people think of Iowa as an external, you know, person who's trying to assimilate, you know, you don't think necessarily of wildlife, you don't think of wild spaces, but there's definitely an appreciation for the species that do exist here and that are continuing to thrive here. So I think, yeah, it could be any number of species, but there's, you know, the full gamut. I'll get that from different landowners that are just concerned and really invested in their species of interest.
Yeah, I mean, I think Tim and I would fall into that category that if we saw something now knowing what we know,
yeah.
and we have your cell phone number now, yeah. right? We're like, hey, what do you think? Here's what we're seeing, right? I could see where that would provide some comfort to the landowner and be very rewarding for your job.
Yeah, for sure.
Cool.
So that brings up, I wasn't planning on going this way, but so if somebody wanted to go contact you, what's the right channel of events to get a hold of you? I mean,
yeah. So, I mean, usually your local field staff is the best person. I mean, they know, you know, maybe your exact location, you know, they're driving by your house. They kind of know what animals are there, what's been happening in the area. So I would really say, and it's not just so I don't have to field a million calls.
That's why we're having the question.
It's to work through your local channels. And they know, I mean, you know, it did take some time once my position was created to kind of let people know that I exist and, you know, for them to remember to like, yeah, loop me in because I have some insights. But at this point, like a year out, everyone knows, I mean, I'd rather hear more than hear less. So if there's any kind of question of whether it's a larger kind of wildlife health issue, they know to loop me in. So
okay.
You'll reach me one way or the other, but occasionally it'll be just direct cold call.
Okay. So the right sense. Channels, so if I'm in a county, what would be that title that you'd want them to be a wildlife biologist?
Yeah, like the unit biologist. You know, really, if you contact anyone, they will know, you know, the appropriate channels to get you to where you want to get.
Okay.
So, yeah.
All right. So let's talk diseases.
Okay.
And so, hey, in fair disclosure, Joel and I are meat eater fans from a podcast perspective. And there's a podcast out there called Meat Eater. I don't know if you knew that.
Heard of it.
And they actually did an episode very similar to what we're doing on CWD. And one of the things that they did is they actually patterned it into a past, present, and a future. And so full disclosure, I really liked how they laid that out. I'm not trying to steal anything else other than, hey, I like the format. So that's what we're going to do. And I want to give them the proper credit that they deserve. So that said, let's talk diseases. So,
okay, my language.
So what are the main diseases? And let's just focus on whitetails, I think, and for this discussion. What are the main diseases that we're currently tracking for whitetails?
Sure. So there's two. Both are occasionally called like zombie disease or, you know, deer zombie disease. It's really a misnomer for both of them, and it leads to confusion. So the two diseases, separate diseases, are chronic wasting disease, which has kind of these long-term repercussions when it enters an area, and then epizootic hemorrhagic disease, sometimes just called hemorrhagic disease, so EHD, and that has kind of these short-term acute effects on a population, and they tend to rebound and recover. Wildlife in general are resilient, you know, to all kinds of disturbances, whether it's natural, you know, like derecho kind of events or disease events. So, but sometimes people have a role to play in, you know, mitigating those effects.
Okay.
So.
All right.
Yeah.
So,
so those two diseases.
So from how representative is CWD and EWD across the Midwest? Is it similar to other states like Illinois, Minnesota?
So, yeah. So if we speak specifically about free-ranging cervids, so cervid is anything from, you know, deer, elk, moose, caribou, reindeer. It kind of incorporates all of those kinds of species. And there are 24 states that are currently dealing with some sort of effects of CWD in North America. So, and also two Canadian provinces. There's a couple other states that only have it in their captive herds, so they haven't found it in their free-ranging whitetails, for instance, or mule deer or something like that. But it's definitely, it's a national issue. It's a continental issue, really. And it's becoming increasingly an international issue because, you know, there's other state, other countries like Sweden, Norway, Finland, that are also now dealing with chronic wasting disease. It's a little bit different origins and different species that are being affected, but it's definitely not unique to Iowa, and we're relatively in the early stages of dealing and managing with this disease. So that, I'll just cut it off there for CWD. EHD, so I know you keep calling EWD.
Oh, I don't mean that. So good correction.
Yeah.
EHD.
We need all the help we can get here, Rachel. So
it's all acronyms, so you know.
Yeah.
If you don't know what the acronym is, it's easy
EHD.
To just... Yeah. So EHD, epizootic hemorrhagic disease, and that is, you know, it's been circulating in the southern United States for decades, to the point where... you know, deer that get infected with EHD, they don't even sometimes show any sort of clinical sign. They don't die. You can find that they were infected because they have antibodies, but there's no real ramifications of having been infected and surviving that infection. Whereas in states like Iowa, when we get the an incursion event, so when the disease enters Iowa, the deer are so susceptible to the disease that they tend to just die. And that just tends to be kind of a quick process. So all you'll see is dead deer. You won't see kind of a buildup of, you know, sick or ill deer. Last year, like in Warren County specifically, where 40% of our cases came from or were reported from, people were seeing kind of these stuporous deer that were kind of walking down the street, not acting right. And it was because there was such an intensity of infection there. There was so much disease burden that they were actually seeing the deer in that, basically the 36-hour window where you see signs. Whereas if it's kind of a lower intensity event, you know, if a deer is in, you know, a forest, you're not going to see it while it's sick. You might just stumble upon the carcass. So there were plenty of carcasses that people were finding, but they were also seeing, you know, living deer, which was a little more unsettling, and kind of where that zombie association comes from, where they were just out of it. They were febrile, so meaning they had a fever. They weren't feeling well. They often associate with water to kind of cool down. So they were finding, you know, floating deer. And it just, it's kind of like a creepy scene out of like some sort of apocalyptic movie. But it's a real, you know, normal disease process. Sometimes it enters Iowa and we get those kind of effects. So
horrible death.
It's terrible, right? So Rachel, on that, do we have any, is there any data out there that if a deer gets EHD, what's the survival rate?
Yeah, so like I said, in Iowa, they tend to just die, but every now and again, there might be a deer, you know, that maybe it got a lower burden of infection, so it just got less virus. So EHD is caused by an Orbi virus, and, you know, or maybe there are genetic predisposition, things like that, that they'll actually survive the infection. And that's what we could expect if we continued to get these disease events in Iowa. Eventually, it's going to be self-selecting, and it's going to be those deer that can survive infection, and we'll be, you know, have a population that responds more like, you know, the southern states where you can't even tell when they've been infected.
So in Iowa, though, I mean, if you had to take a guess, is it 1 out of 10 that's going to survive? I don't want to put you on the spot.
I would say, no concept. I also would not have a concept of that. That's not something that we track. The way that we actually track, you know, the presence of the disease is in terms of carcasses. So sometimes, like, you know, the hardest last year when we were collecting CWD samples, some of our field staff would say, well, I did see these like growth interruptions in the hooves, or, you know, their brisket was kind of worn raw. And those are kind of signs that maybe the deer survived an EHD event. And then it was taken out by a hunter like that same season. Mm. So signs of a deer that's kind of entered that chronic form of EHD, instead of that acute mortality event, it'll affect their hoof growth. So sometimes the hooves will completely slough off, or you'll get like a deep ridge in the hoof that kind of marks that there was a stressor on that deer, which was the, you know, being infected with EHD. And when they're really sore on their feet, you can even get deer that are kind of walking on their elbows, or, you know, that are down rubbing their brisket. So you kind of have to use some other indicators to see.
It's terrible. I had no idea.
Yeah, it's
terrible.
Yeah, it's a rough time for them.
So
for sure.
Last quick question on EHD for me anyway is, they have the potential to build some antibodies, which means immunity, right?
Yeah.
Is that capability passed down from generation to generation?
So, the, you know, genetically, it could be. So if a deer has a certain gene profile that allows it to survive infection, it just doesn't get, you know, maybe it's less attractive to the midges that actually vector the disease. It's possible that can be passed down through generations. Based on the timing of kind of all these things, so EHD tends to emerge in the late summer, early fall, so after fawns are already on the ground.
Okay.
So they aren't necessarily protected, you know, in the womb or something like that. So yes and no.
Yeah.
I think maybe not in like the traditional sense that you might be thinking about.
I think, but what I'm hearing is that there's some hope there, right, at the light in the tunnel, that the more deer are exposed to this, the more they're going to build antibodies up, and then the less we're going to see significant deaths.
Yeah, and I mean, this could take, you know, decades. So it's not like a silver bullet quick fix, but, you know, it's EHD is not a concern for, you know, taking out the Iowa whitetails. Which I think is a big concern that people have when they see, you know, a whole bunch of dead and dying deer.
Yeah, it's scary. Yeah.
So we've been talking about EHD shifting a little bit towards CWD. Are there diseases similar to CWD in humans? And if so, what are they?
So yeah, there's a whole bunch of different diseases that fall into this category of transmissible spongiform encephalopathies. So it's a big jumble of words. Yeah. TSEs, so another acronym, which doesn't help much.
It does when we have to try to pronounce that. So
yeah. So, but in short, they're prion diseases. So whereas a lot of diseases that we hear about, you know, COVID-19 is a virus, EHD is virus, this is a prion disease. So it's not a bacteria or a virus that is transmitting it, or, you know, a fungus or something like that. It's an actual misfolded host protein. And that is the prion protein. So prion itself stands for proteinaceous infectious particle, but we have prion proteins that are not misfolded. So the name is a little confusing because it's not infectious when it's the normal, you know, appropriate form. But when it gets misfolded, and that could be either because of a sporadic cause, so and people, they like one in 1 million people will come down with Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, so CJD, another acronym. And the classic form is it's just sporadically a person will develop a misfolded prion protein, and the weird kind of hard thing to fathom about it is that once you have a misfolded prion protein, it'll make the other prion proteins misfold. So it'll become this infectious or aberrant isoform of the prion protein. And that's how it's spread. So that's sporadic. There's also an infectious kind of form, which is what CWD is. So it may have, a lot of these kind of prion diseases started with a sporadic case, but then it became infectious. So that's how it kind of perpetuated itself. So with CWD, so chronic wasting disease in deer, it's infectious. So once you have a positive or CWD positive deer on the landscape, it can shed these infectious prion proteins through saliva, urine, feces. It's, you know, its carcass itself, if it, you know, is decaying on the landscape, that kind of thing. So, and then other deer that come, or other cervids, so it could be elk or moose, that come in contact with that material, that infectious material, can then get the disease. So that's where the infectious component comes
from. And carcass, let's stay with the carcass, it's dead, it's on the landscape. Coyote comes and eats it, or a bobcat comes and eats it. It's no evidence that it's going to cross.
Yeah, so there's been studies in coyotes and in crows, and it seems like in both of those species, and kind of the likely scenarios that they're transport hosts, so they can move it, move the prion to a new area. You know, when they then, you know, they consume it, then they defecate in a new area, they can actually spread it that way, but they themselves are not susceptible. But
weird, huh?
Prion diseases, they're just hard to kind of understand because they're just very abstract. But there's a whole other component where basically species susceptibility is not static. It's not a static character trait. So if it passes through a species, a new species, it can actually change the susceptibility of another species. So host passage is really critical in this disease where, you know, maybe it doesn't get in to cattle on the first pass, but on the second host passage, it can get quicker and things like that. So there's all kinds of studies that look into that. When exposing animals, like in laboratory kind of experiments, it's usually in a very unnatural way. So it's like intracerebral inoculation. So that means directly injecting infectious material into the brain. So of course, on a landscape in nature, that would not be happening, but it's to kind of to challenge that species barrier to kind of figure out where the risks lie. Wow. So they have done studies where they can inject it directly into the brain of cattle and get cattle that show signs. And then once you kind of recover that material and then inject it into another cow, they'll become symptomatic quicker. So that's where that host passage kind of susceptibility thing is not concrete. And that's why the risk to people from CWD exposure is not something that we can, you know, 100% say that this is okay to come in contact with.
Yeah, sounds crazy.
Yeah, it's
and scary.
It is crazy. That's a great word.
So, I do want to come back. So, we talked about CJD.
Yeah.
I want to make sure I get it right. You know. And you can correct me anytime. I'm all good with it. I've made those kind of faux pas before. So, is it transmissible?
So, CJD.
Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease.
Disease, yeah.
Did I say that right?
Yep. So I'll preface it with this. So again, this is a very complex disease. But for variant Creutzfeldt Jakob. So back in
that was my next question.
there's a lot of diseases and a lot of
I was going to ask the same thing.
A lot of nuance.
Sorry, Rachel.
So Creutzfeldt Jakob is kind of the term given to the human prion diseases, but within that there can be, you know, the sporadic form, which I already kind of described. Then there's the variant form comes from exposure to another prion disease that basically passaged through a human host. So back in the late 70s and 80s, cattle in Europe were fed meat and bone meal. And it, as it turns out, most likely is that there was a sporadic case of mad cow disease, so bovine spongiform encephalopathy, that was then fed back to a whole bunch of cattle, and then it became this infectious form. So it was just this one-off event that then was fed back and became infectious and ended up infecting, you know, thousands of cattle. Now, before it was known when it happened that, you know, that all these cattle were infected, people were consuming the cattle. So they were consuming beef, and in 1996, the first case of variant Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease was diagnosed in Britain, and that was a person who had consumed contaminated meat, or contaminated material from an infected cow. So in other kind of proceeding events, there were things like blood transfusions from a person who developed variant Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, then you know, donated blood, and that blood actually caused another case of CJD. So it's very complex, but it had passed through a human host, and that's why you know, likely that it became more infectious to other people coming in contact with that material. I know, I think we had kind of, maybe a question that'll come up is about Kuru, which is a whole nother human prion disease that I actually learned about. I remember in elementary school learning about this. Did not think I'd be on a podcast 20 years later talking about it.
In Iowa.
Yeah, exactly. And so Kuru, it affected the Foray people, who was an Aboriginal tribe from New Guinea, and they had this ritual of consuming the dead. So when a family member or a tribe member died, they would consume that family member, including the brain material. And so likely what happened there too is that there was one of these sporadic, so Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease cases that happened. Then the tribe was exposed to the brain material, so the specific infectious material. And then, so there was a localized, so it was just affecting this tribe, but it became, you know, an outbreak situation for pretty kind of closed off people. Once they realized kind of what had happened, they were able to mediate or mitigate those risks by, you know,
they not stop being your grandma.
Yeah,
right?
Exactly. So
our grandma's off the menu from here on out.
A culturally sensitive issue, but it, you know, it's like the right circumstance for something as crazy as a prion disease to strike. So.
Holy smokes.
Yeah. So it's very complex. We know that prion diseases can affect people because of kind of these instances. We know that they can passage from one species to another because of mad cow disease and kind of all the consternation that surrounded that in the late 90s, early 2000s. So we definitely don't want a repeat of that with chronic wasting disease, but the risk ultimately is unknown, you know, if people can be susceptible or can become susceptible following, you know, different levels of exposure.
Sure.
So, wow.
So Rachel, we're kind of on the topic, so I'll expand on it here with the question is, so you've got a deer. Unknowingly, you shot a deer or you harvested a deer. It has CWD. What risks does someone have from consuming that?
Yeah. So if we follow CDC guidelines, you know, the CDC is in the media a lot now. Uh-huh.
They're pretty busy.
The pandemic, yeah. But prior to, they have this set of guidelines for You know, if you are hunting deer in a known positive area, proceed with getting your harvest tested. And then if your deer tests positive, to basically get rid of that meat. So to dispose of it, preferably in a landfill, so that it's not, you know, if you throw it out back, a positive carcass, like we already discussed, you know, it can infect other deer or can get transported elsewhere by scavengers. So
raccoons.
So that's the recommendation. That's what we follow. So we know that we have some areas in Iowa that both, you know, historically from our first positive in 2013 up in Alamakee County, and then some new kind of expanding areas. We know that we have the disease in Iowa. So, you know, using your own kind of best judgment to decide if you want to get your harvest tested. You know, right now, so we, you know, last year we tested like 7,300 deer, and we had 44 positives. So 44 animals that came back positive from these pretty localized areas. So it's not that the risk is uniform across the state by any means. And honestly, like that's a very low prevalence number right now. But we also know from other states that have had the disease longer. So like Illinois and Wisconsin, whose first positives were back in 2002 in their free-ranging herds, that basically when you have the disease and it gets established in a new area, basically spatially, it'll increase spatially. So you'll have more areas affected around that local positive, and then also your prevalence will increase. So, you know, this year we tested many more positive animals for Alamakee than we did back in, you know, 2015.
Yeah.
So we're seeing those trends. So the risk is, I guess, only increasing, but it's a manageable risk right now.
So I'm not sure you answered my question.
Okay.
So, so the CDC says, you know, if you know it's contaminated meat.
Yeah.
With CWD, you should not consume it. You should dispose of it properly.
Yeah.
And life goes on. Unknowingly, you know, I'm in Butler County. We were using Butler County as an example earlier.
Okay.
Shoot a deer in Butler County. I don't even know what CWD is.
Right.
This is how I, you know, harvest my meat and feed my family during the winter. What are my risks?
So it's right now it's an incalculable risk. So likely, you know, based on what we see with these other experimental, you know, contexts, you know, right now the barrier, the species barrier between, you know, deer prion and human seems to be pretty robust. We know that people have been consuming CWD positive animals, you know, out in the West, in Wisconsin. We know that this is happening pretty routinely. Some people just don't care. Some people maybe are poorly educated, but some people just, they know it's happening and they don't care. They're willing to assume that risk.
Yeah.
And it might be that it never, you know, is a human issue, but.
And we just don't know the consequences to it yet is what.
Yeah. So I guess I should also say that maybe it hasn't been, you know, clear. The reason that this is so concerning is that prion diseases are uniformly fatal. So to the host species or to whoever, or whatever gets infected by it. So with those people who were exposed to mad cow disease, they ultimately died. So it's kind of, you know, I have this conversation often about, you know, risk with rabies. So if you wake up in a house or in a room with a bat, and you don't know, you know, if you were exposed, I tend to take the side of, you know, taking every precaution, because at the end of the day, if you were exposed, it's a uniformly fatal disease, aside from like, you know, one case.
Yeah.
So similarly with CWD, I think that the risk is so low, but the consequence is so high.
Gotcha.
So in my, you know, if I was hunting and harvesting deer, I would have my harvest tested. But I think that there's something to be said of, you know, using a tiered approach. And if you're if you're hunting in Alamakee, if you're hunting in Clayton or Wayne, where it's been established the longest, in those counties, you know, to seriously consider having your harvest tested. But if you're in Story County or, you know, a place that's pretty insulated right now, now, of course, we have, we've seen, you know, telemetry studies out of Minnesota that show yearling bucks and does walking, you know, 75 miles with their natal dispersal and that kind of thing. So no area is, you know, completely 100% risk-free. But I think you can manage your risk by kind of using where you are spatially based on where another positive is.
That makes sense.
Yeah. How quick is the turnaround test?
So at the peak of the season, we were seeing about a week and a half, maybe turnaround.
It's reasonable.
Yeah, it's reasonable. I mean, if you have multiple deer, you know, and you're waiting and, you know, sometimes there's issues. Meat processors don't want to receive a deer that hasn't been cleared, you know, tested, but also cleared negative or not detected. So some of those kind of factors come into play too, to make sure that you have a way of, you know, keeping the cold chain intact and keeping that that meat.
Yeah.
Excellent. All right. So I want to come back just a little bit if we could. So where did CWD come from?
Yeah. So the first case or the first detection was at a Colorado research facility in 1967. Now, this was a facility that had previously contained research animals that had another prion disease, so scrapie, which is a prion disease of sheep and goats. So it's kind of assumed that there was, because we know, so I guess with a little bit of context, we know that prions can survive on the landscape for years, even decades. There was a study out of Iceland that tested, you know, basically soil material from a contaminated premise, a scrapie contaminated premise, and 16 years later, it was still testing positive, and that those prions were actually still infectious.
Wow.
So, I mean, it's... There are so many reasons that prion diseases are very hard to manage. But that's basically where we think it came from. So kind of another one of these host passage events where it came, you know, was maybe a sporadic disease in sheep that became established, became infectious and transmissible, you know, to individuals of the same species, and then passage to deer in Colorado. And then it wasn't until the 80s that it was found in free-ranging white-tailed deer from, you know, Colorado. And ever since, it's just kind of been spreading. So when we started our CWD surveillance program was in 2002 when it was first detected in Wisconsin and Illinois. And then we didn't detect it in Iowa until 2013, at the tail end of 2013. So, and, you know, and then we, so we... We were definitely surveilling for it, but then it became like it's here now, like the pre and post CWD phase of our surveillance program. So,
all right. So I want to ask just a couple questions. I want to go even back a step just to, so how often do you talk to your Midwestern colleagues about diseases?
I mean, pretty regularly, I'd say monthly. You know, we're always exchanging emails and that kind of thing, so.
Okay. And the reason I'm bringing that up is I want our listeners to know, hey, this isn't just an Iowa thing. I mean, you're pulling on data from all across the Midwest. This isn't just pertinent to Iowa.
It's
pertinent.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I mean, and we're also comparing strategies. So, you know, sometimes things are received better in one state than another, and what kind of motivated that or what allowed certain management techniques to work better or be more effective in an area. So yeah, we're always comparing notes. To be clear, nobody has been effective at eradicating this disease once it's you know, been detected. So so nobody has a cure. No one has a solution right now. So we really are, you know, using our collective energies to figure out what's the best approach here.
Sure. Rachel, on that note, who do you think, you know, who do you look up to for a state that you think they have, you know, they're going the right direction from a
leading
CWD standpoint?
Maybe.
Yeah. You know, I think the two states that have been most effective at keeping prevalence low, but not keeping it spatially restricted. So the disease has continued to kind of move around, but they've had it for several, you know, years and have kept the prevalence low, are Illinois and Missouri. And they both take a particular approach. I mean, some of it's a mixed technique, but they do a pretty intense localized cull, which isn't perfect, isn't a perfect solution for every state, and isn't well received by, you know, the citizens of every state. So I think that they do a great job, but they also are investing, I mean, probably orders of magnitude higher than we are currently. So it's not without a lot of, you know, investment and time and money.
And downside, right? So what is Iowa's program then? I mean, what, you know, what's the approach?
Yeah. So historically, we have been, you know, looking for the disease. Once we find it in an area, we increase surveillance in that area locally. So, you know, any of our kind of at-risk areas, so state borders, like, you know, along Wisconsin's border for sure, because we're very close to there, you know, the county that kind of started this whole, the whole consternation surrounding CWD, Iowa County. So we increase our local, you know, surveillance efforts there, try to increase harvest. I mean, really relying on hunters is critical to our efforts because without getting those samples, we can't see if the disease is changing location or changing in intensity and that kind of thing. And then, you know, we do know that in these areas where it's been established for, you know, like Allen McKee, it does tend to be, it's not the whole county, it's a very specific area. So this year, for the first year, we're implementing kind of a core zone that has also increased harvest opportunities to really get those diseased deer, which we know are diseased at this point. Like, we know that there's diseased deer in those areas, to get those off the landscape. Because the other factor here is that, you know, early intervention is really our best and sometimes our only option here, because once the local prevalence increases enough, you have enough contamination from, you know, saliva, urine, feces, contaminated carcasses. You don't necessarily need to have more infected deer on the landscape to still spread the disease, because you have this environmental component where other deer just interacting with the same surfaces or the same, you know, areas can actually get the disease.
That makes a lot of sense. I mean, so, I mean, if you think about it, I mean, if I have a high density, maybe high density is not the right word, but if I have an increased density of contaminated deer and they are offing all this contamination of these prions. See, I'm a dumbass for a reason. So anyway, these prions, but I can be taught. And so I have all these prions, these bent proteins, if you will, or folded, malformed. Malfolded prions. And what happens is I have so much of them. If I can eliminate those contaminated deer, I'm now having less contamination on the landscape, potentially less contaminating of other deer.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. I mean, that makes sense to me, right? I mean, so, and I can see where the hunters play a pretty critical role in that with regards to a sampling, right? Sampling and also eradicating the disease species.
Yeah.
So has it gotten to the point in Iowa where that the state has called sections or areas?
No. So what we would like to happen is that we get, you know, cooperation from our hunters, you know, from our public to help us and assist us in this effort to, you know, manage for this disease. Because eradication, that's a target that that no state has been able to achieve. But managing, keeping a low prevalence, that's something that I think is reasonable and is something that we can really use, you know, your and your audience's assistance with, is in getting those animals off the landscape.
So we're trying to really, I mean, don't let me put words in your mouth, but I mean, we don't have a cure, right? And it's a difficult, complicated disease. Yeah. So what we're, and there's lots of research going on these diseases, is that right?
Yeah.
So we're really, just like COVID-19, we're really trying to buy science time.
Yeah.
I mean, in a nutshell, right?
Yeah, to some extent, we don't know what, you know, for instance, the environmental contamination part, we don't know what's the effective means for, you know, decontaminating an area, yeah, that has been, you know, trafficked by infected deer. But there's plenty of research interest in that, in answering that exact question. So while we're, you know, in the meantime, trying to keep the amount of contamination low, is really what we can do. And, you know, in other states, like, you know, in states where it's been established longer, I mean, there are other effects. So population level effects, you'll see declines, decreased survival. You know, they're seeing that in Wisconsin, that CWD positive animals, even if it's not because they died of CWD, that they just have a lower survival overall. And that will stress your population and, you know, drive it below, you know, the environmental carrying capacity, that kind of thing. So, you know, currently we're very early in the trajectory of this disease in Iowa, but we don't want to ever reach the point where we're seeing those population level impacts of the disease. So what we do now, though, sometimes it's unsavory, people don't want to see, you know, deer coming off the landscape. It really is in the best interest of the species and the resource.
Yeah.
I mean, that's what I've always heard is, I mean, the Department of Natural Resources, I mean, and you correct me however I, their mission is they're managing this herd for the next 100 years. They're not looking out, hey, next year, hey, did Tim and Joel have good hunts? It's around generations. Is that right?
Yeah, and keeping the hunting culture, you know, viable, mm-hmm. In Iowa and the Midwest.
Thanks for listening or watching our show. We have some exciting topics and guests coming up.
We ask that you subscribe to our channel on YouTube and follow us on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook.
We look forward to hearing your suggestions for topics,
questions, and comments. This is Two Dumbasses signing off. Until next time,
be safe,
have fun, and get outdoors.